So welcome to all our guests. I want to start by getting Tejaswi to speak about whether you think India is now more united than ever before, or do you concede critics when they say that India is more divided than ever before?
Good morning, Rahul. Good morning to such a vibrant young audience. Rahul, undoubtedly, my country is extremely united today. For the first time in the existence as an independent India, the country's constitution applies to each single inch of the country's land. And that itself goes to show that we are a more equal, more united country than ever before. Whenever elections would come, elections were a season of dividing people. Dividing them on the basis of caste, dividing on the basis of language, dividing them on the basis of which family you belong to. But for the first time under the leadership of Prime Minister Narendra Modi, elections truly became a celebration of India's diversity and plurality and celebrating the inherent oneness. When was the last time that elections were fought on issues like good governance, on wanting to make India a better country? But for the first time today, whether you are an Indian in Houston or whether you are an Indian in Tamil Nadu, you feel that you belong to the same piece of land which your ancestors strive so hard to make it free and make it great. This is the country that all of us have been dreaming to work for. The country is extremely united today. Young people today are approaching issues of the past with a fresh mind. They want to take new paths that haven't been explored earlier. Politics has taken a new dimension where performance matters over pedigree. It doesn't matter what surname you carry. What matters more is whether you can deliver the goods to the people when you go to elections. So these are signs of a new India. And I think this generational shift that we are witnessing today is a product of the polity of our times. When the Prime Minister speaks to the Indian diaspora in Houston, he speaks in my language, Kannada. He also speaks in Tamil. He speaks in Punjabi. He speaks truly as an Indian who represents the whole of all of us. When was the last time that we saw issues which concerned all of us, irrespective of our socio-economic background and challenge, being addressed at the very top?
Okay.
Therefore, in summation, Rahul, a new India is a more united India. A new India is where equality before the constitution is not something that is an amorphous ideal, but is a reality in practice. Whether you are a young man from Kashmir or whether you are in Assam, is the same constitution of India that applies to all of us today. And that steely political will is what Prime Minister Narendra Modi has shown to the world today.
Nusrat, if you look at the map of India, the swath of saffron, starting from Haryana, going all the way down to Karnataka, starting from Gujarat, going all the way to Arunachal and Assam, would suggest that politically, India is more united than ever before. Yet, your party and your leader, Mamata Banerjee, seem to suggest that India is more divided than it ever has been.
Very good morning to all present here. How are you guys doing? Can we have this louder? We have like a lot of people in the house. It's almost full house. How are you guys doing? Don't really want this affair to be a very serious one in the first place. Well, Rahul, I genuinely believe that my party does not think that India is divided today. We really believe in unity. We really believe in united cultures. We believe India has always, always been very united from the beginning. So when it comes to my party or when it comes to my chief minister, we just try and keep a check on things which might not be very appealing to all unanimously. We try to keep a check on such things. We are not really against the government. We just want to put in our inputs so that the government works better for the country and it benefits all. So that's all I'd like to say, because I also believe that India has never been more united before than today. We see India as, you know, as an amazing new feather in the cap of the world. So everybody respects India, everybody respects our cultures, and always stand by the saying, I would always stand by the saying that it's united we stand and divided we fall. So that says it all. We are all together, and each and every day. And you know, politics is just not about me being in politics or my fellow colleagues being in politics. I think you're a part of politics. I think everybody present here is a part of politics, because in layman's language, what do you think politics is? How would you define politics? Anyone? Anyone? Are you going to give me a very difficult explanation? Okay, so I will give you a very, very simplified explanation of politics. It's just the ways and ideas that we need today to help in governance. So I think in that ways, if I'm in politics, each and every person here is a part of politics. In that sense, everybody is a part of politics today. Each and every youth in India is a part of politics today, because ideas cannot just be given by the people who make laws, but also comes from the people who abide by the laws. So I really believe that we all are part of one and all, and we all are part of India.
Imtiaz, does India feel more united than earlier or more divided than earlier?
That's for me. Okay, very good morning to all of you. It's a great pleasure to see such a young crowd listening so patiently to the young MPs. And Rahul, let me tell you, the beauty of this country is its unity in diversity. India is the only country in the world where you have so many languages, where you have so many castes, communities, cultures, eating habits different, dressing habits different, but still the country stands one. And that is the beauty of this country. But when you ask me a question, whether in the present era, whether in the present times, India is united or it has divided a little more since the time the new government has taken over, well, let me tell you, you know, I have been hearing this phrase of "Achhe din aayenge." "Achhe din aayenge," I have been listening since 2014. I don't know whether those "Achhe din" have come, but let me tell you. But let me tell you, when I see these youngsters, I have great hope in this country. I have great hope in this country, and more so, "Achhe din aayenge" will not come just because Mr. Modi or the BJP government is saying that "Achhe din aayenge." "Achhe din aayenge" is because of you people. "Achhe din" will come in this country because young politicians, irrespective of what political party they belong to, "Achhe din aayenge" will come because of educated youngsters coming into politics, and that is very, very important. And what better "Achhe din" can we expect when we have Nusrat Jahan also coming into parliament? It's the most beautiful thing that has happened in this parliament, that an actress has come into politics. So it's a great, great time for this country. And yes, we may have difference of opinion. Take your family. Rahul, there's every family have their own problems, own issues. The fact is, there are difference of opinions. We may not agree to certain things, but when it comes to the country, she may come from Congress, he may be from BJP, she may be from TMC, and I am from MIM, but when it matters about the country, yes, we are united and we will remain united throughout, because India is a lovely country, we all love this country, we respect this country. Difference of opinions may come, government may come, but one thing that I would like to say is, India is a democratic country, so please allow the democracy to survive in this country. Don't impose things on the people of this country that here we are in power, so we will allow you to do this, do that, eat this, eat that, don't do this, don't do that. The fact is, this country is a democratic country and the democratic structure should remain. If the democratic structure remains, then the unity of this country remains. If you threaten the democracy of this country, then definitely I think there will be a great threat to this country, there will be a great threat to the unity of this country, and that is very, very important. My young friends, take inspiration from all these youngsters who, having been educated, they decided, but why not take politics also as a career? And that is something, a changing scenario that we are seeing in today's political scene. Youngsters with educated background, highly educated. You know, I was reading an advertisement where recruitment of peons was being done, and the minimum criteria of that was 8 standard pass. India is a country where if you're an Angutha Chap, you can become a lawmaker of this country. That needs to change. Educated people need to come into politics, and that is very, very important. That is very, very important. Thank you.
Okay, Jothimani. The BJP is most certainly more united than ever. Does the Congress feel united? Does it seem divided? Does India seem united to you? Does India seem united to you?
See, as my colleagues rightly pointed out, with different languages, different culture, religion, with amidst so much differences, the country for the last 70 years coexists with harmoniously, united with so much harmonious love. So why this question arises, whether it is united or divided, it's only after 2014 this question arises. That's what I make point. What is united? See, I am from Tamil Nadu. I wear what my states want to wear, what I love. So how the party or a ruling regime or anybody in the power can dictate people what to eat, whom to love, what to wear. So this is what you think unifying the India, which I completely disagree. The young crowd here agree with me. See, they are actually, Rajiv Gandhi brought down the voting age from 21 to 18. Why? Because everybody in India are capable of taking decisions. When you want to impose a language, impose a religion, impose a culture, then India will explode. That's what actually we are fearing of. Then my friend said, actually now under Modi ji, there is a constitution apply across the India. So I beg to disagree with him. I also would like to tell my young friends here, there is a different constitution in Andaman and Nicobar. There is a different constitution in Nagaland. There is different constitution in Meghalaya. There is different constitution in many of the northeastern states. Because of various reasons, special status has to given during those time in different states. Only Kashmir things has changed. Why not other states it has changed? Because Kashmir suits the political narrative. See, when was the last time we discussed about health, education, employment, and freedom? We keep on talking about religion, language. Actually, what the young crowd want, definitely, actually, they are more capable enough to decide which language they want to study. But what is the government responsibility? What is the political people responsibility? Give them good education. Give them good health. Give them freedom what they want to choose. But this, you undermine everything. Then you want to impose one nation, one language, one nation. There is nothing called one nation in India. India is a confederation of states. I speak different language, he speak different language. But we coexist each other. That's what India. India is always united. Now there is a science of division, which I hope these young people will realize it and respond to that.
Tejaswi, the charge against your party is that you're imposing one language, one culture, one idea of India, whereas India is made up of a plurality of ideas. You're trying to homogenize them into one unitary concept.
Rahul, if we approach facts with a non-prejudiced mind, common sense will dictate to us that reality is very different from the delusion that a few people are living in. Our dear friend, my respected learned member of parliament from the AIMIM, spoke about democracy and its strength. While his party in the parliament opposed the abrogation of Article 370, a vicious article which killed democracy in Jammu and Kashmir. Today they come and hear lecture on democratic rights. Jothimani ji, like any young man or girl here, I am equally for the idea that each young man or girl in India must have the freedom to choose and love whoever she or he wants. That's a personal choice that must be respected. But unfortunately, your party does not believe in it, because until the abrogation of Article 370, a girl in Kashmir, if she chose to fall in love with a Kannadiga or a Tamilian, would lose her property rights. She couldn't get her inheritance. She had no choice to love. She had no choice to love who she wants. If she chose to love or marry someone from outside of Kashmir, she had to pay an extremely heavy price. And you opposed that. And today you are coming here and have, and in a hypocritical sense, giving us a lecture on freedom of choice and who we should choose to love. Rahul, the fundamental philosophy of the Bharatiya Janata Party is about respecting the indigenous diversity about India. We respect every culture that is born in this land, whether it is our languages, whether it is our dress, whether it is our customs. It is only the BJP which firmly believes that there is an inherent oneness in the cultural space of India, which apparently is so diverse. I was shocked to know that Jothimani ji, I have tremendous respect for you, but what do you mean when you say India is not one nation? What do you mean we are not one nation? When a fellow Punjabi soldier dies at the border, it doesn't matter if I am a Kannada guy in Bangalore, I cry for him because I connect with him because we are the same one nation. Even today happens to be Lata ji's birthday. I'm sure many of us, or so many of us here, listen to the song Mere Watan Ke Logo. Each time it says, we swell up with tears because in the very song it says, it doesn't matter whether you're from Punjab or Kashmir or wherever, we all die for the same country because we are one nation. How can we say we are not one nation? But we must remember that we are, unlike the United States of America, we are not a federation of states. We are a union of states. It's a very, very big difference between the two.
Rahul, what Tejaswi said is, he is concerned that a Kashmiri girl, if she loves a Kannadiga or any other youth from outside Jammu and Kashmir, he's concerned about that love affair. What I am concerned about is, his Prime Minister Narendra Modi should love all the people of this country, including the Kashmiri people. And that is something that we had opposed. We were not against a 370, but the fact is, since I had said that this is a democratic country, the procedures that were adopted by the present government in passing the bills, never in the history of Indian Parliament, the bills that are being passed, it seems as if there is no structure that exists. It seems there is no procedures that exist. We would have definitely supported the bills, because unless and until you take people into confidence, you should have taken the people of Jammu and Kashmir into confidence. You should have let that bill passed in the Kashmir Assembly, and then you should have come in the Parliament. But just because you have the numbers in the Parliament, you bring
like
about the bills in the Parliament, you bring
the
about the bills
years.
In the Parliament, you let those bills pass, and then say, if we are opposing, oh, we are anti-nationals. No, Mr. Tejaswi, just as you feel proud to listen to Lata Mangeshkar's song, Sare, Hey, Mere Watan Ke Logo, the entire country shouts with me, Sare Jahan Se Acha, Sare Jahan Se Acha. That is the beauty of this country, Mr. Tejaswi. Governments will come and go. Your government is also for 5 years. If you take the people along with you, you will be here for another term. But if you don't take the people along with you and say, now it's going to be the dictatorial form of government, that day is not far away when you will also have to go, Mr. Tejaswi.
When
you.
I said India is, I never said India is not one nation. When I say Tamil, it's also include I'm an Indian. But don't say to me, you don't read Tamil, I will impose Hindi on you. Second, as he rightly said, as per the law which they brought into Parliament regarding the Kashmir 370, any state, not only Kashmir, in my state, any state, without your consent, without your view, any state can be divided into 3 or 4 union territories, which we will not agree. That's what actually we, his party and my party and her party, stood the ground in the parliament against the perception, against the lies which spread outside the parliament. We want each, every one of us rights has to be respected. You want to do something to my state, listen to me first. There is an elected assembly which my people voted in my state. Let them respect that. See, there is a structure in this India. As you said, I also say India. There is a panchayat structure which you don't follow. This Panchayat Raj ministry itself abolished because it gives a right to last mile man through Gram Sabha. Then there is a state legislative assembly which has entitled to make law regarding state. Then there is a parliament. Do you think people vote for panchayat? Do you think people vote for state? Does not have any value. Then why do you want to contest panchayat election? Why do you want to contest state assembly election? Directly contest you have a national elections and you go for a president's rule. That's what you are aiming. When you are saying one nation, one language, one nation, one religion, then you would like to undermine the power of every Indian citizen. You want to consolidate the power in the one person hand, whoever it may be, the prime minister or the president, whoever it may, you undermine every citizen. What we are fighting for from 2014 is, you are taking my right, you are taking every one of this young people right, which we vehemently oppose, we will oppose till the end.
I also completely agree with my respected colleagues. It's just that, you know, we're living, each and every day, we're living the preamble to our constitution. We know our rights, we know our responsibilities, we know our duties. But does that say that when we make about changes or when we bring about situation in the country which affects the people of the country, I don't think that is being called democracy. I strongly believe, my party strongly believes that the integration of 370 Act is very, very welcoming. It's very, as an Indian, we all really agree to this bill. We were just trying to oppose the fact that we also have, each and every Indian has the rights to be understood, to be able to express their feelings. So without taking the people in Kashmir in confidence or without really giving respect to their authoritarians, the decision which was taken could have been taken in a better procedure is what we were talking about. So nobody exactly here is opposing the bill because it was long pending and it is a good one. It's a very, very good move by the government, but the government needs to also take care of how people feel in India. Okay. It is very, very important.
So I want to use a moment since there's so many young people sitting here in this audience watching on television to ask all our young first-time MPs what drove them to politics. I'll start with you, Nusrat. You were at the peak of your acting career, and when people hear you speak, they scarcely can believe that this lady is a member of parliament. Why is it that you chose to leave aside a flourishing career in acting to want to join the madness of Indian politics?
Firstly, let me just say, I did not leave my flourishing career in acting. I just wanted to contribute, to make a contribution in governing, in administration, so that we all flourish together in the near future as a good government, as a more flourishing government. That's all I wanted to do so that, you know, being in politics gives you the space to perform in a larger scale, to think more about people, and to voice your thoughts, which is very, very important in today's times. I think every youngster in the house will believe that we need to represent their voice also. There are certain things, there are certain policies, which is policies addressing the youth, which might not be, experienced by our veteran politicians. So they might not be able to frame the right kind of solution to our problems. So here we are, it was high time that we had to step inside politics and start bringing in new, fresher, innovative ideas. That's all I wanted to do.
Okay, Imtiaz, you used to be a journalist and a fairly successful journalist. At that, you chose to enter politics in a state where the AIMIM didn't have a very strong base. They come primarily from Hyderabad, obviously very strong there. You're now an MP from Aurangabad. What drove you to politics?
Well, let me be very honest about this. I was a journalist, my dear friends, just like Rahul. I was a journalist with a television channel for 12 years. I started my career with a newspaper in Maharashtra. I was with them for 12 years. So I had an experience of 24 years as a journalist. And every day was a routine affair, running after news. But one fine day, I realized that after 24 years, my experience was that whatever you write in the newspaper, whatever you show on television news channels, in the name of democracy, the ultimate power rests with the people who you elect. So it's those 400, 500 odd parliamentarians who actually run the show in this country. You may feel satisfied writing a good story in the newspaper. You may feel satisfied, happy, showing a good story. But does it have an impact? No, it doesn't have an impact if you really want to bring about the change. I said, if I really want to change the system, then I will have to be a part of that system. And thus I took that decision. So after running after the news for 24 long years, one fine day, Rahul, I decided, why run after the news? Why not me be the news myself? And so I decided to quit journalism. I entered politics just 1 month, to be precise, just 22 days before the elections. I decided, I went to my hometown in Aurangabad. I was heading the Western Maharashtra Bureau for a television channel in Pune. And when I went to Aurangabad, all the shady characters of my city, all the shady characters, criminals of my city, were vying to get a ticket from different political parties. I told my friends, how could you allow this guy to be your MLA, to be your leader? He has shady character. He has criminal cases against him. How can you allow him to be your leader? And there was, when I researched, I found that there was not a single politician who was educated and who was trying to get a ticket. So one fine day, we were sitting in a dhaba, and I was trying to convince my friend, why don't you take a ticket? You're educated, you have finance, you have everything, you could easily win. And he got irritated and he said, do you think it's that easy to win elections? Now you have left your job, you are no more a journalist, you're not doing anything, why don't you join politics? And that night I gave a serious thought, why am I telling others? Why can't I plunge into politics? The next morning I told my mother, mom, I want to contest elections. And she thought I got crazy. She thought I lost my job, I don't have a job. And she said, hey, you go and spend some time with your family somewhere. Don't think about this thing. But I was firm in my decision. And ultimately, I decided, yes, I will try my luck. In those 22 days, I worked 20 hours every day. And when I contested and fought the elections, I won with a thumping majority of 20,000 lead against 3 sitting MLAs. So that was a transformation that I took from running after the news to being the news myself.
Nice. What I really like about Jothimani is that her name is not Gandhi, it's not Deora, it's not Sindhya, and yet she's a Congress MP. How difficult, Jothimani, is it for a non-dinist on the basis of her hard work and performance to get a ticket in a party that is so entrenched in dynasty?
See, that's a perception. There are a lot of people like me sitting in the Congress party. See, my thing is, I came to politics in their age. Actually, frankly speaking, nothing is attracted to me to politics. I born and brought up in a small village, still I live there. So where actually Dalits are actually denied drinking water, where there is a excessive drinking water. So for me, I feel it's an injustice to them. So there was a famous Tamil MGR song. I was very naive, very young to think. I play cricket with boys, gilli danda with boys, climbing trees. Whoever confront with me, I beat up boys. So this is what I did before joining politics.
Tejaswi, be careful.
No. Now, after reading Gandhi, I become non-violent. So then I thought actually that MGR song, this, I can't sing. I simply say, na 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 ittal, adu nadandu vittal. Roughly, I can translate English. If I pass an order, it's implemented. The poor people need not worry. This is a rough translation of that. So I thought that point of time, I have a power. So if I can change the scenario. So my only purpose to get into politics is a kind of act of injustice to resolve the drinking water, nothing more. I thought I was just 22, after 5 years I can get out of politics. So that was the time Panchayat election happened after 20 years gap in Tamil Nadu 1996 with women reservation. The credit goes to Mr. Rajiv Gandhi. Without him I might not able to sit here because I came through the women reservation. So then I fought an election, I won, 5 years I worked. Then I realized that actually I didn't finish, that's just a 15 days job bringing water to the area. But it took 3 years for us because caste is something which is completely gripping the Indian society. It's not easy for me as a youngster. As a woman, then generally officers will take you for granted. So as a young lady, what she knows. So then we put up a lot of fight against the caste system, against the, I can say actually, heartless bureaucracy. Then finally it took 3 years. So then I realized that I need to do more job. So I decided to stick another 5 years, not more than that. So once 10 years completed, by the time I walked parallel in the Congress party, so I realized that's very important for young people like me who stick to politics, because politics is totally incompetent, corrupt and heartless. I thought actually I can replace one such person in my capacity. So I stick to politics after 10 years. So I'll tell you, Rahul, it's when Rahul Gandhi, many people say he's a Gandhi, then he took a drive. When he took over as a Youth Congress General Secretary, he found the only dynast, powerful people, daughter, son, who are rich only sitting in the Youth Congress office. So he went for a nationwide drive to find out people like me who really mean politics. So we, many of us actually brought to Delhi, then we've been given a position in the Youth Congress. We have traveled across the country to build the next generation leadership in Congress. So unlike you people thinking, there are next generation leadership in the Congress without any surname, sitting every state. There is a CLP leader in the Gujarat, Mr. Paresh Danani, who can't speak proper English at that point of time. I don't speak Hindi. So we work together. That's not the beauty of India. So he's a CLP leader at the age of 41. So there are Raja Birar, who actually established himself in the Badal Bastion in Punjab, who doesn't have a surname. There are many of my colleagues, actually, who really fight from the beginning, who walked our way up, actually sitting in the Congress party, because he himself said, I am the system, I'm the symptom of the disease. I don't want Congress party suffer with this. So there are many youngsters actually who fight back in the system, actually supported by him. When my candidature was discussed, I can frankly say, because my party president Tamil Nadu said in the press conference, everybody said actually I am coming from a humble agricultural background. I have to fight against a seasoned politician, five-time MT, Deputy Speaker of Lok Sabha, Mr. Thambidurai. I should not be given ticket because I don't have money. I cannot win an election. But Mr. Gandhi put his full faith, single-handedly actually announced my candidature. I won with thumping majority of 4,20,000 votes against the Deputy Speaker of Lok Sabha, Thambidurai. Mr. Sendil Balaji, who is sitting here, who is a DMK District Secretary and former minister, actually who actually helped me to run the elections. He is also a non-dynast. So there are a lot of people actually non-dynast who can perform politics. Actually, at the young age, actually, I also would like to tell them, not an advice, a suggestion, you can fight an election at the once you complete 21. It's a panchayat elections. It's a Nagar Palika election. Not necessary. Everyone has to fight MLA, MP directly. You can still have fun. Life. Still going to college. Still whatever you want to do. Still you can get active into politics. Please do come and we are ready to retire early.
I'm just very curious to know, amongst the people sitting here, how many would be willing to consider a career in politics? If yes, put your hand up. So they're very few, Tejaswi, you know, despite all the appeal the Prime Minister has, and Tejaswi's case is very interesting because...
So I would like to compliment those who raise the hands, because that's not their fault. We want to make engineers, we want to make scientists, we want to make doctors, but we tell the young kids, don't become a politician. It's a fault in the education system, fault in the society, fault in our house. So it has to change, then I will see the more hands will raise. Thank you.
You know, Tejaswi's case is very interesting because when Anant Kumar, who was the senior BJP leader from Bengaluru, passed away, it was widely anticipated that his wife would get the ticket. And instead, a young man who hadn't turned 30 was given a ticket. And his first reaction on Twitter was, OMG, like, oh my God. Like, you were very surprised with the fact that you got a ticket, which you weren't expecting, Tejaswi.
Rahul, getting a ticket definitely was a big surprise. But the fact that the BJP identifies young talent, the fact that my party respects meritocracy, the fact that my party allows for people without big political backgrounds, even if they come from modest families, to go up is something that has precedence. So though it was a surprise that it was me the party chose, the in-principle decision of giving opportunity to young people wasn't itself a surprise. But my story about how I came to politics, why I was interested, Rahul, is because when I was in school, I was exposed to the works of three people. And those three people, when I started reading them deeply, had a profound influence on my ideas. One was Swami Vivekananda,
second was Veer Savarkar, and third was Baba Saheb Ambedkar. When I read the three of them, I felt that the idea of India that they espoused, there was only one political party that very closely echoes and resonates that idea, and is the BJP. Therefore, I joined the youth wing of the BJP. I worked in the party's Yuva Morcha, and I have grown through the ranks of the party working for the ideology. So the reason why I respect leaders like Jothimani ji is because from a very young age, they came into politics because of an ideology which drove them to work for it. It was not because of immediate access to power. It was not because they knew that they are going to come to office tomorrow. But they came in because, but in her specific case, she came in because she felt she could make a difference, because she believed in an idea and she was ready to fight for that idea come what may. So if someone can lay claim to becoming the Prime Minister of the country on the only qualification that his great-grandfather, father and grandfather were Prime Ministers, then we must definitely encourage people like Jothimani ji and others who come without that baggage, who can qualify on the basis of their talent, capacity and strength to occupy public offices.
So you are saying ask Jothimani to tell Rahul Gandhi to make way for her. Upside ho ja, Jothimani is coming. You'll get her into trouble.
That's for her to comment on.
No need to bring Rahul Gandhi every time. He actually resigned as a Congress president. He brought people like me. I told actually many of the youngsters got ticket against the senior leader's bill. So he brought us, every one of us in every state. So actually it's no need to bring him everything, because he did his job for last 10 years. He created a generation of leaders for the Congress party. So we should give credit to him, not discredit
him. Who did he do a good job for the BJP and for Modi, or for his party? Because the Congress itself is less than 50 seats. So he actually did a great job for the Prime Minister and for the BJP.
Rahul, actually elections, a party win or lose an election for different reason. BJP lost deposit in Tamil Nadu. Out of 39 seats, we won 38 seats. So that means Narendra Modi failed each and every Tamil people. The same happened in Kerala. Rahul Gandhi won with 4.5 lakhs votes. Actually, completely even CPM devastated. Punjab we won. The two states, in my view, it's my not necessarily my party view, the two states we announced the Prime Minister candidate is Tamil Nadu. DMK, our alliance, has announced Mr. Gandhi as a Prime Minister candidate. Kerala, he himself contested. We announced him as a Prime Minister candidate. The two states swept. The Congress party made some error in the last election in like 2014. So you cannot blame one person. See, you want someone who's really dignified, who's really nice, who want to empower people, who want to decentralize power, who really walk from the back, who does not want to any publicity. So you want to mock him. It's a loss to Congress party and the country, not to him. Actually, with all humility, I would like to say this to you, please.
So we're heading towards assembly elections in Maharashtra, in Haryana, and it seems very one-way traffic. You know, it's a very unexciting election, Imtiaz, because the BJP is so strongly placed in Maharashtra with the Shiv Sena, strongly placed in Haryana. So I want to now focus on whether Prime Minister Narendra Modi is the greatest contemporary Indian politician, or is India's opposition thoroughly useless?
Rahul, this is a very interesting question, especially in the backdrop where we are having elections in Maharashtra. And what we are seeing today is, you rightly said, that there's no ideology left in politics today. By hook or by crook, everybody wants to come into power. And what we are seeing is a whole bunch of politicians from the Congress and the Sharad Pawar-led NCP, who were till yesterday fighting against the BJP, who were till yesterday fighting against the Shiv Sena. The whole lot of people switching over sides. And yet, till yesterday, they were with their respective parties for years and years together. They became MLAs, they became ministers, they became also powerful. And suddenly, you see all these people joining the BJP and the Shiv Sena. So where is the question of ideology? There's no ideology left in politics. You want to enter political, you want to gain political power, and you see that the BJP is emerging stronger. So leave your party and just join them. That is, unfortunately, the reality of the situation in Maharashtra. You know, Rahul, till yesterday, all these Congress and the NCP people, whenever we used to fight elections in Maharashtra, they would charge us, they would blame us, saying, we are the B team of the BJP.
So every time we stood up to fight elections anywhere, they would make a charge against us. See, they are the B team. They are contesting elections because they want to help the BJP. And today we are seeing those same people going and sitting on the laps of the BJP and the Shiv Sena. So where is that question of ideology? It's just that they see that the greener pasture is on this side. So leave everything. Join them.
Okay.
So that is what is happening in Maharashtra
today. So you know that the BJP runs a big Swachh Bharat scheme. And it's not the cleanliness and toilet scheme that I'm talking about. It's a scheme being run for opposition leaders who have enforcement directorate or CBI cases against them. If you have CBI or ED hounding you, Tejaswi, all you need to do is join the BJP. Then you are Swachh Bharat. It's all cleaned up. Your cases are forgotten. The CBI forgets you. The ED forgets you. Before that, BJP leaders say, Bhag Mukul, Bhag, CBI aati hai. And then you're like, oh, Mukul is suddenly now in the BJP. You know, she's laughing because it's from her state. So this second Swachh Bharat scheme, this is not what you promised the people. You said there'll be cleanliness, there'll be toilets. But here there's a political cleanliness Swachh Bharat scheme that you're in.
Thank you, Rahul. I would just want to say that the Prime Minister and the party firmly believe in the autonomy of investigating agencies. And for the first time, these agencies have been given a free hand. And if the who's who of a few political parties are now being investigated, it is not a political witch hunt. It is nothing more than rule of law, which is being allowed to be exercised for the first time without any fetters. So if people are against rule of law, then, well, you may cry.
You are not answering the question. It's not about those who are being investigated. The point I'm making is, when they're in opposition, they are being investigated. When they join your party, everything is forgotten.
Not at all. The very idea of autonomous investigating agencies is that they are free to choose who to investigate, who not to investigate. No one gives them diktats. So if a particular person is being investigated today, it is because the bosses at the investigating agencies, the leaders at the investigating agencies, those authorities have decided that they have to be proceeded against.
Yes, Jothimani wants to come in and Imtiaz also. Yeah, yes.
He said actually agencies are given free hand. The last 2-3 days what we are seeing, the law student was accused Chinmayan and the former BJP ministers of rape. Now the agencies actually has filed a case against the victim. So this is what the situation here. So every agency will get the free hand. Prosecute, before that there is a Kathua rape case in Kashmir. Actually where national flag was actually raised in the support of a rapist. So this is what the India we would like to see.
Rahul, this is a very, very serious thing that we are witnessing in this country. Those autonomous bodies who had their own power, now the political interference, just to give you an example, NCP chief Mr. Sharad Pawar is being asked to produce before the Enforcement Directorate just 1 month before the elections in a scam that dates back to 2007. The BJP and the Shiv Sena are in power in Maharashtra since 2014 to 2019. And for a scam that dates back to 2007, suddenly because he's aggressively campaigning for his party in Maharashtra, he's told, appear before the ED because there's a case pending against you that dates back to 2007. I don't subscribe to Raj Thackeray's brand of politics, but the fact is, when Raj Thackeray's MNS is aggressively campaigning against the BJP, Raj Thackeray is told to appear before the ED for a scam for some financial irregularities that dates back almost 10 years back. The problem, Rahul, is you have the government, and please let the autonomy of all those bodies, whether it's the CBI, whether it's the IB, whether it's the Enforcement Directorates, the Income Tax Department, let them remain powerful. The day you start interfering in their affairs, the country is going to witness very bad days if you start interfering in such organizations.
Mr. P. Chidambaram,
and BJP
case,
is doing that.
Even Mr. P. Chidambaram case, 13 officers who signed before Mr. P. Chidambaram are not guilty. 14 signatory Chidambaram is guilty. So this is not a vindictive politics, then what else?
Sir, sorry, but how so much ever you want the act of limitation to not apply to criminal law, the law as it stands in India today, you may have done a crime 50 years ago, but you will have to pay for it
whenever the long hand of justice comes and knocks your door. There is no act of limitation for criminal law. No,
but is this just a coincidence that all this is happening just when the elections are 28 days before and you tell the ED and the police to take back that case of 2007? Why was your government sleeping from 2014 to 2019? Why you did not act the moment your government came into power in Maharashtra? You should have ideally called Mr. Sharad Pawar and said that there is a case pending against you of 2007 and we are going to act. You waited for 5 years and waited for just 28 days when the elections are near. You tell your enforcement directorate, you tell your police to act against all these people. Is this not vindictiveness?
So we don't tell. They do on their own volition. That's the difference.
Okay, Nusrat, why is it that political traffic in this country is such a one-way street? Even in Mamta Di's West Bengal, we saw the BJP do phenomenally well in the Lok Sabha elections, which was way beyond what Didi expected. Is this a reflection of Narendra Modi as contemporary India's greatest politician? Or is it also a reflection of the fact that the opposition simply doesn't know what to do?
You really can't say that because you always, in a democratic country, you do need an opposition, like I said previously, to check on the activities of the ruling party. So, you know, if you ask me, I feel every party is just fighting amongst each other for just one country, for the people of our own country. I think we should all settle down and come down to the same page and decide what to do for the betterment of the country. And as far as elections are concerned, we like challenges, you know. And when you get a challenge, your performance in your next is way, way, way more better. So you, it came, if you say that BJP has got more seats, if you compare than the last time, yes, I do agree. But people in Bengal are still for Didi, by Didi, and of Didi. They really love our CM there and they will always be loving our CM there. So we are not really focusing on what to do with the opposition or with the ruling party. We are really focusing on how to work for the betterment of our own people.
You know, what I really liked about Nusrat's campaign was that wherever she went in Bashirhat and was campaigning and when people would say, can you sing a song for us, she'd often sing. So I'm kind of wondering, would you like to hear Nusrat sing just a little bit of a song for
us? I think that's impossible. Yeah?
Are you sure? I can't hear you. Do you want to hear her sing? Because she sings really well. And in her campaign, she was singing quite a lot. So do you want to hear her sing? Okay, Nusrat, that's
I think this is impossible. You know, I have done that once or twice maybe on stage. And then Rahul, it was a special performance for you on a show. I don't really sing. I'm not a singer, guys. I've not even sang in the bathroom.
This is a new Indian neta. You know, like a very different neta from the neta that we've seen earlier.
Because, yes,
Achha, okay, neta, two lines.
First of all, let me just finish. Neta, of course. Different neta, of course. But then, I think calling me a representative of the of people would be way more better. Neta is too heavy word for youngsters today. What do you think? Do you really want to be a neta or do you just want to represent your own people?
See, you are a neta. You don't feel like a neta?
I feel like I'm representing my people. I feel like I'm representing my culture. And I represent my own thoughts and views. No?
You, Imtiaz, you think...
Which language would you like to hear? I know Bengali, Hindi.
Hindi. Hindi, Bengali, Hindi. Two lines each in Hindi and Bengali. She sings really well, so she should sing really.
He is... No, don't believe him. Which song would you like to hear?
You pick, you decide.
I decide. I get requests from there, what's it?
You decide, we leave it to you.
This is so difficult, yeah. They're asking me to sing. I've been coughing in between, I think it was caught on camera as well. I think since I stand for my culture, I would like to sing a Bengali song. Would it be very difficult for you all to understand? Very? Music has no language, sweetheart. Just try and keep a humming and, you know, give me that beat of claps. Come on, like one, two, three. Everybody, you all have hands. Come on. Aaja kashir shathe ek shundhi korechi megheri jil khanai toke bondi korechi. I need claps. One, 2, 3, that's nice. Aaj akashir shathe ek shundhi korechi, megheri jilkhanay toke bondi korechi. Mon bolechi amar aaj shonge jabe tor, morbe aram kore ar bajbe bodo jor. Shob kichu periye habe raat chhariye bhor. So thank you so much. This was a song that means that I need you all to come along with me and put your hands forward, and we are all supposed to walk together. This is exactly what the song means. It talks about love. It's from one of my films, and you know, films teach a lot to the young people today as well. So this was a nice message through a song that I could portray, that we should all come together.
I told you she sings really well, right? And can we
have a round of applause? I just sang very well or not. Please don't judge me.
Although that was in Bengali, most of them wanted you to sing in Hindi. Do you want to hear her just a little bit in Hindi?
I don't know which one.
You pick any. We leave it to you.
Hame tumse pyar kitna, ye hum nahi jaante. Was that beat? Magar jee nahi sakte tumhare bina. Hame tum, he just laughing, you know, the way I sang it. He's just laughing. This is so embarrassing, but thank you so much for all the support. It's been really fun. Thank you.
You know, now when she was singing, Imtiaz and you know, Tejaswi were looking and they were very scared. Ye hume na bol de gaane ke liye, don't worry. Unless you want to volunteer, Tejaswi.
Spare them the trouble.
Spare them the trouble.
They could handle me, they can handle you as well.
Jothimani, you know, everybody like, oh, isi ko karne do, we don't want to get stuck. Imtiaz?
My only request to, please be regular to the parliament, because your presence will make more attendance in the parliament as well.
I think this question had come up to me long back, you know, it was Rahul and few other people who always said that, you know, your attendance in the parliament would bring in more attendance. I think it gives me a lot of pleasure and honor to hear something like this. There is much more to the beautiful face, of course, but if it's doing some kind of social service, I don't really mind.
No,
everybody's
well
more
also.
Welcome.
You speak well also.
Thank you.
Do you feel this burden chase you, Nusrat, of being a big star coming into politics? You know, there's so many. I don't want to use the word, but there are lots of fuddies in politics, right? Like, you know, there are all these old people. Suddenly, you got these young film stars turned politicians. It's very different from what you expect from the Indian Neta.
I think that's the change we were all wanting to, get about. I think it's time that somebody takes the initiative to get new people from all fields. It does not really have to be somebody being a student leader. Then he or she becomes becomes a politician, or someone who's been into the political family will become a politician. I think politicians are welcome from all aspects, from all the other fields, from anybody sitting here in the audience to somebody standing on the road waiting for their bus. Everybody has their own views to express and be a part of the Indian politics. So it's very, very important.
So as we wrap up this session, I want quick final words from everyone, and I'll start with Imtiaz. For everyone sitting here watching and sitting at home or on social media looking at what you're saying, is it worth being in politics? Do you regret having left what you were doing to come into politics? Do you think you're being able to make the change you wanted to make?
Yes, definitely. This is a very conscious decision that I had taken, and my earnest request to all the youngsters, you people are very young, and the best part is what we are seeing today is a changing phase in the political scenario of this country. This country will grow and prosper and progress only if educated people come into politics, and that is very, very important. Since I joined politics, I realized that yes, as a journalist, whatever I was doing, I was not 100% satisfied with what I was doing and what I was achieving out of that. But since the time I entered into politics, I realized that the real power rests with the politicians in this country. So it was a conscious decision, it was a good decision, and I'm not repenting the decision that I had taken. But my only request is the next time when we meet, I would like to see more hands coming up, because politics also, you can't blame every politician to be wrong. Unless and until good people enter into politics, there are people who would sit in their drawing rooms in an AC chamber and they would criticize and condemn everything that is going wrong in this country. It's going wrong because the good people are not coming into politics. Unless and until good people take politics as a profession, things are not going to improve. So my request to you is, take this profession also seriously and you could bring about the desired change. Thank you.
Okay. Tejaswi, have you enjoyed your experience? You're much young. You must be about half the age of everybody else, or maybe less than half the age of everybody else in your party.
Yes, but I have truly been blessed to get very good seniors across party lines. So when you are in the parliament, Rahul, whether it is Shashi Tharoor, whether it is so many leaders from the opposition, they all have taken so much of time out to mentor you, to tell you what is right, what is wrong. So I think being half their age has kind of helped me, because they see me, you know, as someone who is their age of their son or daughter, and they take that additional affection and care to say what is right or wrong. So to all the young people here, I just have one small request to make. Whatever field that we choose to pursue in our life, whether it is politics, your engineering, whatever you want to do, my only request to all of you is, do what makes you very happy. If the work that you do itself is going to give you the greatest joy and happiness, then do not worry about what entitlements, what salaries, what comes with it. So if it is journalism, if it is politics, if just doing it itself gives you immense happiness and joy, then that is exactly what you must be doing. So follow your heart, and very good luck to all of you. Thank you so much.
This has been a fascinating conversation at India Today Mind Rocks. I want to thank all these young MPs. They've got long, bright careers ahead of them. And we hope to have them back at different opportunities. But for the time being, Imtiaz, Jothimani, Tejaswi and Nusrat Jahan, thank you so much for joining us at India Today. You know, since this is... Yeah? Oh, she wants to sing another song, she says.
No, I don't really want to sing a song. You know, just like Tejaswi said, just do what your heart wants you to do. I'd like to also say that try and be more part of the politics, because it's 200% worth it, you know, judging it from the far, saying and having a strong sense of negativity towards politics will not be helping. We need more people to come up. And if you think it's negative, try and change it into the positive one, because politics gives you a bigger space to influence people rightly and positively, and it is the only toolbox to change. So just come up and be a part of it without any excuses. On that note, I'd like to say a few lines. If you say Irshad, what's it?
Irshad.
Vakt ke saath badal jao, ya phir vakt ko badalna seekho. Vakt ke saath badal jao, ya phir vakt ko badalna seekho. Are baki hai yaar, ruko. Majbooriyon ko mat koso. Majbooriyon ko mat koso, har hal mein chalna seekho. Don't stop at anything. Don't let anyone or anything stop you for anything. Go achieve your dreams. And here's wishing lots of love from all of us here. Thank you. You have got, I'll have a great day.
So since this is Mind Rocks, as we conclude, can we have a selfie with everyone else in the back? Come, we'll take one selfie. Thank you so much. Can we have a warm round of applause, please, for all of them?